obviously with the breakable rocks as well through the center to open up another avenue attack. So I think that generally from the proto side of things, going to be hyper aggressive. Obviously he's Chinese as well, so that adds another layer of hyper aggro from his side. But you know, to take us into this, Alex, for this best out of five, we have our first player down in the bottom left. As our pink Zerg, it is going to be none other than Scarlett.
That is correct. That is the best out of five. We are, cheers, man. As we are in the top right-hand side, his opponent, of course, is going to be the red pros known as Jim.
And right off the bat, Alex, 12-12. I believe that was for Scarlett. Yeah, 13-12.
Yeah, 13-12.
Is what she decides to go for right off the bat.
Super quick speedlings.
Yeah, pulling down the drone as well.
This is a big deal, though. Jim decided not to go for the scout right away. Instead, Scarlett is faking that she's going to get a hatchery very, very quickly. And instead, Jim right now is missing the scouting info.
Yeah, dude, that's very important. I really like this move from Scarlett because Jim, he thinks he's blocking the hatchery, right? But as he's going to come up here with the probe, he's going to see the gas, he's going to click it, so he knows, okay, damn, that's a pretty quick pull. Eightlings in production. Take us to the natural, Alex. Jim, what is he going to be doing here? Because he's only got the gateway on. Oh, God, Alex, he went Nexus first. This is the worst possible opening versus what Scarlett is doing. She's taking the initiative right away in this series, not going to give Jim any sort of leeway into it, and this is going to be a next to impossible hold, I want to say. He needs to pull probes for this one.
Definitely. This is going to be so difficult, and this is all due to Scott also making sure that that probe doesn't go up. Because she sent down the drone, because she was faking, right now Jim has to make something happen here. He's using the probe, probably in her position here, trying to get the pylon for a bit of a more solid wall off. But is it going to be enough? A very interesting way to wall things off, pulling probes right away, but there's no surface area for those probes, so the Link's going to fight really well, and Scarlett focusing down the pylon, getting it right away. Doesn't unpower the gateway for long, though, as the Zealot is getting closer and closer to finishing.
Cancelling the second gateway here from Jim. Very interesting decision. I don't think I agree with it. You really want to make sure that you have decent production going. He would have the second gateway up by now, so he could have had like 3-4 Zealots, which also gives him an avenue of counterattacking potentially later on. But needs to be very careful with the positioning. Toolings make their way up into the main base, and they start chipping away at these shields. Man, this just the way that Scarlett is controlling this is so smart, because Jim is not only losing a ton of mining time, but this is also going to be delaying any initial like build follow-up that he wants to be doing.
Very nice micro for Scarlett as well. She's barely lost any links, and she's killing quite a few of these workers. Oh God, very nice
so
here.
Damage.
You don't want to take that engagement against a Zealot, but so far, 7 workers killed. That's a beautiful number to start things off here in the very first map. And right away, Scarlett getting the Evil Chamber, drop a lord on the way. She will never stop this aggression. She's just making more and more links, still on 15 workers. But remember, she needs to do more damage than this if she wants to win.
Yeah, the hatchery going down there, mainly going to be for the additional lava. And Scarlett has some great control again, picking off even more probes. Photon Overcharge got down in the natural. And she's just going to pull away. More links streaming across the map. Additional queens also being added in. This drop Overlord, man, is just such a nuisance. An Adept is on the way here for Jim. And he's chasing these links around in the main base, but man, he's losing more probes.
Yeah, but Scarlett's still making more links. Like, even though she's getting probes right now, she needs to deal much, much more damage than this. There's no indication that she's going into any kind of eco. She's still just going completely semi-all-in with this. Trying to get this around, though. This is a nice amount of links coming in from Scarlett. At the same time, there's no photon overcharge just now coming up. But the pylon is kind of injured. Could go down soon.
The overlord positioning here for Scarlett is perfect as well. It allows him to get up onto that high ground, into the main base, bypassing that pylon. Like you pointed out, though, Alex, it is very low, so that is going to fall eventually. Many of these links are damaged. But only more Zerglings on the production lines here for our Canadian Zerg. And she's done a really good job so far. Jim, on the other hand, I want to commend him. He's sort of stayed calm in this. But what do you do? Your natural is wide open. Ooh. There's a drop overlord that ferries links into the main base, and even more probes end up falling.
I think Scarlett could actually take the engagement here against the Zealots if she wanted to. She can even get more links into the main. And here we go. How many units do we have? We have 2 Adepts as well. Where are they? They're in the natural right now, not doing anything really. And well, Scar's trying to come in here. Not really enough links to go for the surround, but getting close to that number. Now getting to that natural as well. And I gotta say, the microphone score at this game has been superb.
Oh man, really nice pullback as well there to make sure that those adepts can't get any free damage on the links who are running around there.
Oh my god, those adepts are gonna die, Tenshi.
Oh, one might get isolated. Some great mineral walking there from Jim to try to buffer for them, but it's not gonna be enough. Eight additional workers fall. There's still a decent number of links here. Two adepts pop out now, with the third one joining him. Finally going to clean up the lost lings, but the damage has been absolutely tremendous. 13 probes remaining. Scarlett back to droning, adding in a few more zerglings. Just make sure that those adepts can't find any additional counter damage. But Jim, he's in a terrible position.
Yeah, it was so important that Scarlett did find her one moment to really make those drones. And she did. She found the interval where she felt she had enough lings. So right now, going up to 33 workers here and 16, it doesn't get much more. It doesn't get much better than this. And once again, the link top is set up and there's no unit in sight for this. There's one Stalker. Those adepts are so far away on the map. This is devastating for Jim.
I love this from Scarlett. She just changes her avenue of attack. Gonna put unload six Zerglings into the main base. Adepts, like you pointed out, man, they're way out of position on the reconnaissance mission, but they are gonna be getting those comms that there is something going down back at home. More probes will end up falling. Jim, yeah, I mean, he realizes that I'm way too far behind, and he's gonna tap out of game number one.
What a game from Scarlett. And even just, usually when you do this kind of build, like, yeah, you're going to deal a lot of damage as you go really far ahead, and then you can transition into a bit of a macro game. But this was just such a brutal beatdown in the very first map.
The damage control from Jim was initially good, but I'm really coming into question that cancel on the second gateway, mm-hmm. because that served to wall off as well, because there was like a lot of space in between the first gateway and the pylon. There were like two hexes. So you need to actually have two units on hold position to block that off, and Jim only had a single Zealot. I think that was like the most crucial mistake there, that he just gave away too much space in the natural, which then gave him enough time to set up the drop overlord as well, comfortably. And obviously the lack of production, because, I mean, he's only squeezing out a single unit at a time.
Yes. I also think a big deal here was the fact that he was running around chasing the Lings. I think he should have actually left those Zealots right in the middle of the mineral line. So if Scott actually comes in and tries to attack his probes, he can easily defend right away and also pull his probes around the Zealots.
But it's really hard, you know, because you have to worry about the natural too, right?
Oh, yeah. But like when he was at the point where he had like two Zealots and two Adepts.
Oh, yeah.
Because he was splitting them up. But I think it's a very difficult position to defend. It is.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, being Protoss, I've been in that position so many times. It's like the bane of my existence, man. I think like 90% of all my losses in Legacy of the Void is because Lings get into me, like into my main base of natural expansion in the early game. And you're just like...
Yeah, I mean, this is the kind of build that I want to see from Scarlett, though. She's so good at just these really quick, micro-intensive kind of battles.
Yeah, I love it.
Yeah, this is what I want to see from a Nurture, a Laser, and Scarlett. These are the players that really can do this well. Iasonia has also been known to do this, but he's out of his... He's kind of out of it right now.
That's just like... Right off the bat, like going for such a build, I was like, hey, that's sort of like Bly, you know?
Yeah, it's very like
Bly. That was the first thing that I was thinking, right? But guys, coming into game number two, here in this best out of five in the rounds at 12, victor of this series is going to go off and face up against Maru. So that is also going to be a very tough one if you make it out of the rounds of 12, but at least you guarantee yourself, I believe it's like $8,000. Mm-hmm. Anyway, here we are on Whirlwind. And in the top right are Red Protoss. Hailing from China, is down on game already. It is going to be Jim.
His opponent in the bomb left-hand side on this huge macro map is going to be, from Canada, Scarlett. And well, Tenshi. Scott in the first game going really aggressive. This time, Hatchery first. Not going to see that super early speedling play. And I gotta say, this map, I really do think Scott has a fantastic chance on as well. Just because on the previous one, it's much easier to kind of start splitting up the map, going to that long macro game. Whirlwind is one of those maps that, yes, it's kind of built as a macro map, but you have so many avenues of attack. Your third is so far away from your natural, and you have to split up your army really well. And of course, you can fly in with those mutas in any direction.
You're such a ninja sometimes, Alex.
I'm a what?
I'm gonna. I'll tell you later, man.
Okay.
But you are very right, dude. It's. I think sort of similar to Frost in that sense, that it's easy to look at the map and go like, yeah, you know, I can be super greedy on this one. But that is not always necessarily the case. However, Nexus first from Jim. I am a huge advocate of Nexus first. Whenever I can get away with it, of course I go for it. I love those sort of builds. And I've been...
Then you start seeing the drone coming by.
Yeah, dude.
Like, why is he drone scouting? And then suddenly the links come in.
I've been killing myself with Nexus first since Wings of Liberty, okay?
I remember, like, when we... Every time we Skype and you play, like, why is he drone scouting me?
Oh, man. Vani Research Station. Drone comes up into my main. Like,
It's so many times.
But that's in HOTS, though.
That's in HOTS, exactly.
Like, it doesn't happen anymore. But so for this one, Jim... I mean, he's been trying some of these... Twilight Council Robo builds, where he actually goes Robo Twilight, which delays the teching a little bit. And then he hasn't even been going for these super quick warp prisms either, which sort of leaves me a little split, because I feel that he's not being super effective with all of the potential aggressive options that you have as a Protoss, especially on a map like this. You know, there's so much airspace, so warp prism is obviously really good.
Oh. Scott's going for the really quick Evo Chamber again. Ooh. I think she might want to try link a bit drops. Of Link drops and also getting that plus one as well, which is so cool, because when you get the plus one attack for your Links, you really start shredding those Protoss like nothing else. And Protoss tend to not get those armor for quite some time.
I mean, armor's never really been a priority upgrade for Protoss. In PvT, sure. Back in the old days, you'd get like armor zealots with charge. I don't really see that all too often nowadays, though. But one single Link comes into the main base of Jim, sees the Twilight Council, but I don't think that Scarlett has seen the Robo. But obviously, Twilight Council first is always one of two things. Either it's going to be into those like Resonating Glaive builds. Sometimes we see Charge nowadays. That's sort of become a little bit more popular. But then also you have the Dark Shrine, of course. But Resonating Glaive starts... So, I guess it's going to be one of those Adept drops, or perhaps even Adept All-Ins that we saw Jim use to actually take a game off of... struck from my mind right now, but yeah, he went for an Adept All-In and it worked.
So this is going to be a very interesting clash of builds, because Adepts are pretty good, but when you have a lot of Speedlings and Banelings combined, it can be really difficult to actually deal with it, since you don't have any real good tanks and you have to split really well if it's a lot of Banelings. But if it's not a lot of Banelings and a lot of Lings, you don't want to split, because then the surface area gets too big. So very interesting here to see both these compositions really clash here. See a lot of gateways going down from Jim, who's getting ready for that drop. And of course the warp is into the base of Scarlett. But Scarlett now, she goes up to 40 workers and a few more are on the way. But I think we're going to see a pretty big Link swell soon enough here.
I mean, we should, because Scarlett has seen that there's no third base going down. She's got an Overlord in position as well. I don't know if she saw the War Prism. Okay, that Link should definitely have seen it,
though. It was definitely in vision.
Yeah, okay, so Scarlett should know. Stalker and hold position in the Wall-Up as well. I mean, all the alarm bells should be going off, but this is really nice. She's forcing defensive warpers back at home, and Jim really doesn't want to be forced to warp in on his side of the map, because, I mean, he also has as many units as he can towards the Zerg side of things. Some static defense also going down there. So Scarlett, I mean, she's going to be setting herself up very nicely to hold this.
Dark Shrine coming down from Jim, who's up on 5 gates right now. So Jim, looking for some follow-up pressure after the first initial attacks. Now Scarlett, does she have any Banelings? 5 right now. I would like to see a few more, but she's gone really heavy into the defense here. She wants to make sure she doesn't take any damage whatsoever from this. And with the amount of Links she has, I'm pretty sure she's not going to. But it all depends on the angle of attack, of course, because if those Banelings don't do much damage...
Oh, need to split. I mean, it starts quite decently there, but... Okay, actually, that was really sick by Jim, man. So sick. Scarlett also...
The War Prism!
War Prism going down! That's a massive pickup. And this should effectively shut down all the aggression.
Beautiful.
Oh, dude, on this map, yesterday, Jim versus Kellos, he had a second War Prism. That's exactly what he needed in this circumstance. And I mean, he's going to start the second one, but this attack did nothing.
Yeah, and that third setup is not going to happen. I mean, you can vote in Overcharge how much you ever want to. Those things are still going to tear through that pylon. We see Scarlett starting to transition, getting that eco going, and right now Jim will have a really hard time setting up that third for a bit now. He's forcing a lot of warp-ins. And of course now, he does have the Dark Shrine, so we can see the DTs coming out. But we already have a few Spore Callers out. And of course, a Lair on the way.
I mean, Scarlett has got all of the tools that she needs here to basically hard counter the composition that Jim is using right now. I mean, it's going to be Adepts, couple of DTs, maybe even make them into Archon. But versus all of these plus one Lings, it's going to be so, so tough. And Scarlet's creep spread is starting to further extend itself out on the map, so the mobility is going to be even better here for Scarlet. And she knows, man, no third base. She knows that Jimmy's going super all in with this. It's like a layer cake for the Chinese players.
Yeah, an all-in cake.
Yeah, you start small and then it just expands.
Right now, Jim is moving out on the map here with a few Archons. Really liking that decision to not go for those DTs, instead just using the Archons in front to tank. But, of course, Scarlet has been adding only units. He went up to 56 workers, which is okay number. Doesn't go overboard with it, adding so many Banelings. Just gotta watch out, though, because there is a choke here with those destructible debris right next to it. So gotta be careful, but that's a lot of energy on those queens as well.
Yeah, really important that you point that out, Alex. The transfusions here to keep that spine crawler to cement the defense, really key. Big wolf, big swell with morphing Banelings. And bear in mind, even though there's no Baneling speed on top of creep, splitting is going to be really tough. He wants to use the Archons to soak the Banelings. Good focus fire here from Jim. Is it going to be enough, though? Scarlet wrapped around from left and right. Banelings on all sides. And the last Archon gets isolated and taken out. Yeah, this is going to be it.
Yeah, Jim so can't many do anything. Banelings. Jesus. I mean, that's a textbook goal attention.
Yeah, that was just perfect from Scarlet. Absolutely perfect. To you Zergs out there, watch and learn. This is how you do it. Jim, obviously, with a little bit of an unorthodox all-in on top of an all-in. But in this position, like, it's so tough. And now with Baneling speed finishing up, it's going to be even harder. Jim, so far behind. I think this game is going to be over soon.
Yeah, he's trying to warp in even more, but that's going to be GG. And Scarlett takes the second map really quickly as she's now up 2-0 against the Chinese player.
A very quick start here to this series. Can he turn things around, though?
It's going to be difficult.
He's just doing all-ins on all-ins on all-ins. Mm. I just think this is what we're seeing is a just lack of confidence to go toe-to-toe with Scarlett in the longer game.
I mean, well, in the first game, it was actually Scarlett going for the semi-all-in. So, I mean, Jim never really had a chance to go for it. And then now in the second game, like, he was trying to go into the third base behind the pressure, but that's not going to happen when you have like that many links.
Yeah, no way.
So Scarlett playing this very cleverly. She's not going for that super greedy kind of macro reactive style that we do see sometimes, because it does open up for so many variables that you can't always scout for. But I got to say, though, what's so impressive with this, what Scarlett did now, was she was adding the plus one for the Hydra. She added the Hydra den.
Yeah.
So behind this, she was ready for an attempt at a third, going into Hydraling Bane and hitting that disgustingly good time.
Yeah, she had all of the tools like back at home that she was setting up, just so in case that it can't just utterly crush him with this first wave of units, she has the perfect follow-up, because, I mean, at this point, the gases are so late for Jim, he's going to be starting to mine out his main base, so he doesn't really even have all that much money to squeeze in those very important units, like the splash damage, stuff as disruptors, more Archons, and then Hydras. I mean, gateway units, terrible versus Hydras. It's perfectly played out there from Scarlet. And now we're going to go into game number three, ladies and gents. Overgrowth is going to be the potentially deciding map in this best of five in the rounds of 12. To see who's going to be the first player to move up and face off against Maru, but also secure those $8,000 to pocket.
And that's a lot of money just for
it is a lot of money. I mean, especially if you live in China.
Oh, yeah. I got to say, though, the one who wins this and goes up against Maru, that's going to be a difficult one.
Yeah.
I mean, basically, it's going to be the final boss. Like,
yeah. I mean, Maru is favored to win the whole thing.
Yeah, definitely. I think right now it's like Maru and then TY, and then we try to find out like who's going to be number three, basically.
For my number three is actually Showtime.
Number three for you is Showtime?
Yeah.
That's an interesting pick for me, yeah.
Because, I mean, his TVP is so sick. Mm-hmm. Even though he did lose to Maru. Mm-hmm. That was to Maru. He's still playing so, so well. Mm-hmm. But coming into this game, guys, here we are in the top right, in the pink. Hailing from Canada, she's one game away from moving on to face off against that big, scary Dark Souls boss that is Maru. It is going to be Scarlet.
Her opponent in the bottom left-hand side here in Overgrowth from China. Right now down two games, though. It's going to be Jim.
Also, I correct myself. It was TY that I was meant
was
to
TY,
say,
right?
But I keep mixing, like when I'm talking about them like that, I always mix them up like, hey, yeah, it was Maru, it was TY. But
sometimes
no.
It can be difficult though, because we have so many games off of stream as well, while we're doing it, so
yeah.
It happens, it happens. It's
is,
okay.
It is hard to keep track of everything sometimes.
Oh, I'm actually, I'm actually
a
super
forward to the front here for Jim.
Whoa.
Yeah, that's a really quick forward. Jim going for it? Oh, he's doing it.
Oh my God.
I love
Alex.
It.
We're back in 2013, man.
Yeah, is this Hasbro casting right now? What's going on? Jim right now gonna go for that cannon rush, and Scarlett has no scouting intel on this whatsoever.
We're lacking like proxy Dark Friend Stargate. Yeah. Then it'd be Haas. Like,
for a full Haas game. Yeah.
Yeah, dude. But here we go. Forge is going to be finishing up. Zealot being chronoed as well.
Yeah.
Oh, this is this is so weird, man. I haven't seen anything like this for so, so long.
So this could be interesting. Since Scott has no info on this, and she doesn't pull the drone down to the natural, this is kind of weird to me that she doesn't scout for it.
But I think she doesn't go like this kind of all-in, you know?
Yeah, she probably isn't expecting this at all. Now, the question is, because this hatchet will finish, how is she going to react? Does she stay on one base and try for some tech build, trying to go into Nidus or Spire or whatever? Or does she just try for the counter right away? We do see the Roach Warren coming down right away for Scarlett, so she's going to try on one base, not pulling any drones whatsoever, not building any Spire close, so she definitely is giving up the natural.
Yeah, I mean, she has to at this point. That is completely forfeit. Unit production right away. Like you said, Roach Warren here is going to be the big playmaker here for Scarlett. She is mining a decent amount of gas off of two, so she will be able to get ravages. And now this is like really tough. This is what I think what sort of phased out the whole cannon rushing thing, because you rely on them to defend versus roaches and links. Ravages completely negate that with their superior range of corrosive bile and even the auto attack. So we have to see now, how does Jim respond, or handle rather, the response from Scarlett?
Yeah, it's going to be up to Scarlett now to put on the pressure and Jim to just defend and be ahead basically. Scott doesn't get any drones outside here as well, so she doesn't have any hatcheries hidden on the map.
Nice. Kills that morphing roach, by the way, so just...
Mm-hmm. One less roach to deal with.
Yeah, I mean, lava at this point, Alex, when you're only on one queen, one hatchery, is pretty insignificant.
Especially when you're adding double, or rather one creep tomb at a time with one of the queens, so she actually misses one inject with this, so yeah, every lava does count. Mm.
Well, two ravages morphing. Stargate rides away. I think this is the by far best option to defend stuff like this. You can get a Void Ray, which of course is very powerful. But this is a little problematic again, I feel, though, for Scarlett. She has revealed her hand, which means that Jim is going to be able to start preparing himself by getting Stalkers and just things that have range to at least challenge the authority of these units.
So Scarlett's still making queens. She's going to go slowly across the map, and I'm talking like a snail's pace right now with these queens together with those ravages. The problem right now for Jim is that he doesn't really have anything in the front to defend against the ravages except for the one mothership core, but we're going to see the first oracle come out. I think we need to see some void ray to deal with the queens right away, because that's the biggest issue here for Jim.
Yeah, void ray, I definitely agree with you, Alex. That for me would be the clear choice here, because not only is the void ray consistent damage, you can also deal with the roaches with prismatic alignment.
Ooh, nice hits.
Oh.
Yeah, I guess the mothership core, actually, that's somewhat of a big deal, because those queens can actually start focusing it down later on.
Yeah, but I mean, like you said, snail's pace, Alex, that's what it's about. We're gonna wear this down a little bit. Photon overcharge already popped. Gonna get one ravager, that's a good start. And here come the queens. They do have some transfusions available to them. So needs to get that oracle out. So the second oracle on the way here for Jim. I mean, obviously the DPS output is really powerful, but energy is going to be the main issue, especially when you start losing these pylons, man.
Yeah, it is going to be very weird here for Jim, since he's going to have to be fighting queens with the Oracle. But I like this for Scarlett, that she keeps adding queens and more roaches behind this. She's kind of going for this desperate move. Right now, we've got to watch out, though. You cannot be losing any ravages, already down one of these, of course.
This is so tough, man. These queens, those are the big things that complicate the situation entirely here for Jim. A third queen joins the fray. So many transfusions available. Lots of ravages as well. They're going to be breaking down the pylon.
Oh, those pylons fall, there's not going to be any more oracles right now. And there aren't enough oracles to deal with the queens. This is actually a pretty brilliant attack for Scarlett, I gotta say. And there we go, it's unpowered. The third never goes out. And that injured mothership core does go down as well. And right now, Jim is running for his life. Those ravages just killing everything.
Oh, man, this is so sick. Scarlett powering down all the structures, further hampering the production. Gonna take down the cybernetics core, the oracles. They move across the map for a desperation move there. There is a sentry on the high ground, but no force field going down. Obviously, she can crush the force fields as well with those corrosive vials. Goes directly for the pylon. No gateway units here for you. Scarlett with an excellent counter move. Jim putting all of his eggs in one basket. And there's already a small crawler to greet him. Oh man, what a way to fall out here in the rounds of 12.
Yeah, I gotta say, I wasn't too sure about this put from Scarlett, but she kept making queens, she kept riding those
so
ravages.
So
beautiful game from Scarlett, and once again, GG.
That was so smart, man. Like, moving slow queens across the map like that, sure, they take a while to get there, but they accumulate energy over time. And the big thing is the anti-air, because the Stargate is like the one thing you worry about when you go for some sort of roach-based attack like that.
Yeah. Because also, you have to realize there's nothing that can outrange the corrosive bile that the person will have. So the only thing you have to worry about is actually the Stargate.
Yeah, just air units.
Exactly.
And queens, obviously, with transfusions, counter air units very, very well when they're in low numbers.
Yeah.
So, yeah, just great reaction from Scarlett. Jim falling out, obviously. Valiant effort in this last game. I like it that he decided to go balls to the walls. Like, hey, you know what, guys, screw it.
Yeah,
we're just gonna.
He went really hard for this final game, but I gotta say, Scott just showing what an experienced player she is.
No, absolutely, Alex.
That's what's so difficult about someone like her, because although Jim is also really experienced, you know, the way she plays, it's so hard to just hard counter her.
You also have to consider the fact that like, the level of play that Scarlett has experienced in, like her playing field, has always been at a significantly higher level for a much longer period of time, if you compare it to Jim's. But guys, so that is the first game here today at WESG at the finals. We're going to go to a quick commercial break before we return with the next series, which is going to be Showtime versus Eleza. And the winner of that one is actually going to go up against XY, my boy. So stay tuned for that one, because that's going to be sick. We'll be right back. Obviously, with the breakable rocks as well through the center to open up another avenue attack. So I think that generally from the proto side of things, going to be hyper aggressive. Obviously, he's Chinese as well, so that adds another layer of hyper aggro from his side. But, you know, to take us into this, Alex, for this best out of five, we have our first player down in the bottom left. As our pink Zerg, it is going to be none other than Scarlett.
That is correct. That is the best out of five. Cheers, man. As we are in the top right-hand side, his opponent, of course, is going to be the red pros known as Jim.
And right off the bat, Alex, 12-12. I believe that was for Scarlett. Yeah, 13-12.
Yeah, 13-12.
Is what she decides to go for right off the bat.
Super quick speedlings.
Yeah, pulling down the drone as well.
This is a big deal though. Jim decided not to go for the scout right away. Instead, Scarlett is faking that she's going to get a hatchery very, very quickly. And instead, Jim right now is missing the scouting info.
Yeah, dude, that's very important. I really like this move from Scarlett, because Jim, he thinks he's blocking the hatchery, right? But as he's going to come up here with the probe, he's going to see the gas, he's going to click it, so he knows, okay, damn, that's a pretty quick pull. Eightlings in production. Take us to the natural, Alex. Jim, what is he going to be doing here? Because he's only got the gateway on. Oh, God, Alex. He went Nexus first.
This is the worst possible
opening versus what Scarlett is doing. She's taking the initiative right away in this series. Not going to give Jim any sort of leeway into it. And this is going to be a next to impossible hold, I want to say. He needs to pull probes for this one.
Definitely. This is going to be so difficult, and this is all due to Scarlett also making sure that that probe doesn't go up. Because she sent down the drone, because she was faking, right now Jim has to make something happen here. He's using the probe, probably in her position here, trying to get the pylon for a bit of a more solid wall off. But is it going to be enough? A very interesting way to wall things off, pulling probes right away, but there's no surface area for those probes, so the Link's going to fight really well, and Scarlett focusing down the pylon, getting it right away! Doesn't unpower the gateway for long, though, as the Zealot is getting closer and closer to finishing.
Cancelling the second gateway here from Jim. Very interesting decision. I don't think I agree with it. You really want to make sure that you have decent production going. He would have the second gateway up by now, so he could have had like 3-4 Zealots, which also gives him an avenue of counter-attacking potentially later on. But needs to be very careful with the positioning. Two Lings make their way up into the main base, and they start chipping away at these shields. Man, this just the way that Scarlett is controlling this is so smart, because Jim is not only losing a ton of mining time, but this is also going to be delaying any initial like build follow-up that he wants to be doing.
Very nice micro for Scarlett as well. She's barely lost any links and she's killing quite a few of these workers.
Oh God,
very
so
nice here.
Damage.
You don't want to take that engagement against a Zealot, but so far 7 workers killed. That's a beautiful number to start things off here in the very first map. And right away, Scarlett getting the Evo Chamber, drop a lord on the way. She won't She will never stop this aggression. She's just making more and more links, still on 15 workers. But remember, she needs to do more damage than this if she wants to win.
Yeah, the hatchery going down there, mainly going to be for the additional lava. And Scarlett has some great control again, picking off even more probes. Photon Overcharge just got down in the natural. And she's just going to pull away. More links streaming across the map. Additional queens also being added in. This drop Overlord, man, is just such a nuisance. An Adept is on the way here for Jim. And he's chasing these links around in the main base. But, man, he's losing more probes.
Yeah, but Scarlett's still making more links. Like, even though she's getting probes right now, she needs to deal much, much more damage than this. There's still no... There's no indication that she's going into any kind of eco. She's still just going completely semi-all-in with this. Trying to get this around, though. This is a nice amount of links coming in from Scarlett. At the same time, there's no photon overcharge just now coming up. But the pilot is kind of injured. Could go down soon.
The overall positioning here for Scarlett is perfect as well. It allows her to get up onto that high ground, into the main base, bypassing that pylon. Like you pointed out, though, Alex, it is very low, so that is going to fall eventually. Many of these links are damaged. But only more Zerglings on the production lines here for our Canadian Zerg. And she's done a really good job so far. Jim, on the other hand, I want to commend him. He's sort of stayed calm in this. But what do? Your natural is wide open. Ooh. There's a drop overlord that ferries links into the main base, and even more probes end up falling.
I think Scarlett could actually take the engagement here against these Zealots if she wanted to. She can. Number three for you, Showtime.
Yeah.
That's an interesting pick for me.
Because, I mean, his TVP is so sick. Mm-hmm. Even though he did lose to Maru.
Mm-hmm.
That was Tomaru. He was still playing so well. Mm-hmm. But coming into this game, guys, here we are in the top right, in the pink, hailing from Canada. She's one game away from moving on to face off against that big, scary Dark Souls boss that is Maru. It is going to be Scarlett.
Her opponent in the bottom left-hand side here in Overgrowth. From China, right now down two games though, it's going to be Jim.
Also, I correct myself, it was TY that I was meant
to say,
right?
But
I keep mixing, like when I'm talking about them like that, I always mix them up like, hey, yeah, it was Maru, it was TY. But
sometimes it can be difficult though, because we have so many games off of stream as well,
it happens.
It is
hard to keep track of everything sometimes.
Oh, I'm actually
super
forward to the frontier for Jim.
Whoa.
Yeah, that's a really
wait,
quick
wait,
forward.
Wait, wait,
is
wait.
Is Jim going for it? Oh, he's doing it.
Oh my god,
I love
Alex.
It.
We're back, we're back in 2013, man.
Yeah, is this Hasbro casting right now? What's going on? Jim right now, gonna go for that cannon rush, and Scarlett has no scouting intel on this whatsoever.
We're lacking, like, proxy Dark Friend Stargate. Can it be Has? Like,
for a full Has game? Yeah,
yeah, dude, but here we go. Forge is gonna be finishing up Zealot being chronoed as well.
Yeah.
Oh, this is so weird, man. I haven't seen anything like this for so long.
So this could be interesting, since Scott has no info on this, and she doesn't pull the drone down to the natural. This is kind of weird to me that she doesn't scout for it.
But I think she doesn't go like this kind of all-in, you know?
Yeah, she probably isn't expecting this at all. Now the question is, because this hatchery will finish, how is she going to react? Does she stay on one base and try for some tech build? Try to go into Nidus or Spire or whatever? Or does she just try for the counter right away? We see the Roach Warren coming down right away for Scarlett, so she's going to try on one base, not pulling any drones whatsoever, not building any Spire close, so she definitely is giving up the natural.
Yeah, I mean, she has to at this point. That is completely forfeit. Unit production right away. Like you said, Roach Warren here is going to be the big playmaker here for Scarlett. She is mining a decent amount of gas off of two, so she will be able to get ravages. And now this is like really tough. This is what I think will sort of phase out the whole cannon rushing thing, because you rely on them to defend versus roaches and links. Ravages completely negate that with their superior range of corrosive bile and even the auto attack. So we have to see now, how does Jim respond, or handle rather, the response from Scarlett?
Yeah, it's going to be up to Scarlett now to put on the pressure in Jim to just defend and be ahead basically. Scott doesn't get any drones outside here as well, so she doesn't have any hatcheries hidden on the map.
Nice. Kills that morphing roach, by the way, so just...
Mm-hmm. One less roach to deal with.
Yeah, I mean, lava at this point, Alex, when you're only on one queen, one hatchery, is pretty insignificant.
Especially when you're adding one creep tumor at a time with one of the queens. So she actually misses one inject with this, so yeah, every lava does count.
Mm. Well, two ravages morphing. Stargate rides away. I think this is the by far best option to defend stuff like this. You can get a Void Ray, which of course is very powerful. But this is a little problematic again, I feel, though, for Scarlett. She has revealed her hand, which means that Jim is going to be able to start preparing himself by getting stalkers and just things that have range to at least challenge the authority of these units.
So Scott's still making queens. She's going to go slowly across the map, and I'm talking like a snail's pace right now with these queens. Together with those Ravagers, the problem right now for Jim is that he doesn't really have anything in the front to defend against the Ravagers except for the one Mothership core, but we're going to see the first Oracle come out. I think we need to see some Void Ray to deal with the Queens right away, because that's the biggest issue here for Jim.
Yeah, Void Ray, I definitely agree with you, Alex. That, for me, would be the clear choice here, because not only is the Void Ray consistent damage, you can also deal with the Roaches with Prismatic Alignment.
Ooh, nice hits.
Oh.
Yeah, I guess the Mothership core, actually, that's somewhat of a big deal, because those queens can actually start focusing it down later on.
Yeah, but I mean, like you said, snail's pace, Alex, that's what it's about. We're going to wear this down a little bit. Photon Overcharge already popped. Going to get one Ravager, that's a good start. And here come the queens. They do have some transfusions available to them. So needs to get that Oracle out to the second Oracle on the way here for Jim.
Map going to that long macro game. Whirlwind is one of those maps that, yes, it's kind of built as a macro map, but you have so many avenues of attack. Your third is so far away from your natural, and you have to split up your army really well. And of course, you can fly in with those mutas in any direction.
You're such a ninja sometimes, Alex.
I'm a what?
I'll tell you later, man.
Okay.
But you are very right, dude. It's, I think, sort of similar to Frost in that sense, that it's easy to look at the map and go like, yeah, you know, I can be super greedy on this one. Mm. But that is not always necessarily the case. However, Nexus first from Jim. I am a huge advocate of Nexus first. Whenever I can get away with it, of course I go for it. I love those sort of builds. And I've been...
Then you start seeing the drone coming by.
Yeah, dude.
Like, why is he drone scouting? And then suddenly the links come in.
I've been killing myself with Nexus first since Wings of Liberty, okay?
I remember, like, when we... Every time we Skype and you play, like, why is he drone scouting me?
Oh, shit, man. Vani Research Station. Drone comes up into my main. Like,
It's so many times. But
that's in HOTS, though.
That's in HOTS, exactly.
It doesn't happen anymore. But so for this one, Jim, I mean, he's been trying some of these Twilight Council Robo builds. He actually goes Robo Twilight, which delays the teching a little bit. And then he hasn't even been going for these super quick warp prisms either, which sort of leaves me a little split, because I feel that he's not being super effective with all of the potential aggressive options that you have as a Protoss, especially on a map like this. You know, there's so much airspace, so Warp Prism is obviously really good.
Oh, Scarlett's going for the really quick Evo Chamber again. Ooh. I think she might want to try a bit of Ling Drops, and also getting that plus one as well, which is so cool, because when you get the plus one attack for your Lings, you really start shredding those Protoss units like nothing else. And Protoss tend to not get those armor for quite some time.
I mean, armor's never really been a priority upgrade for Protoss. In PvT, sure. Back in the old days, you'd get like armor zealots with charge. I don't really see that all too often nowadays, though. But one single link comes into the main base of Jim, sees the Twilight Council, but I don't think that Scarlett has seen the Robo. But obviously, Twilight Council first is always one of two things. Either it's going to be into those like resonating glaive builds. Sometimes we see charge nowadays, that's sort of become a little bit more popular. But then also you have the Dark Shrine, of course. But Resonating Glaive starts, so I guess it's going to be one of those Adept drops, or perhaps even Adept All-Ins that we saw Jim use to actually take a game off of... struck from my mind right now, but yeah, he went for an Adept All-In and it worked.
So this is going to be a very interesting clash of builds, because Adepts are pretty good, but when you have a lot of Speedlings and Banelings combined, it can be really difficult to actually deal with it, since you don't have any real good tanks and you have to split really well if it's a lot of Banelings. But if it's not a lot of Banelings and a lot of Lings, you don't want to split, because then the surface area gets too big. So very interesting here to see both these compositions really clash here. See a lot of gateways going down from Jim, who's getting ready for that drop. And of course the warp is into the base of Scarlett. But Scarlett now, she goes up to 40 workers and a few more are on the way. But I think we're going to see a pretty big Ling Swell soon enough here.
I mean, we should, because Scarlett has seen that there's no third base going down. She's got an Overlord in position as well. I don't know if she saw the War Prism. Okay, that Ling should definitely have seen it,
though. It was definitely in vision.
Yeah, okay, so Scarlett should know. Stalker and hold position in the Wall-Up as well. I mean, all the alarm bells should be going off, but this is really nice. She's forcing defensive warpers back at home, and Jim really doesn't want to be forced to warp in on his side of the map, because, I mean, he wants to have as many units as he can towards the Zerg side of things. some static defense also going down there. So Scarlett, I mean, she's going to be setting herself up very nicely to hold this.
Dark Shrine coming down from Jim, who's up on 5 gates right now. So Jim looking for some follow-up pressure after the first initial attacks. Now Scarlett, does she have any banings? 5 right now. I would like to see a few more, but she's gone really heavy into the defense here. She wants to make sure she doesn't take any damage whatsoever from this. And with the amount of links she has, I'm pretty sure she's not going to. But it all depends on the angle of attack, of course, because if those banes don't do much damage...
Need to split. I mean, it starts quite decently there, but...
Okay, actually, that was really sick by Jim, man.
So sick. Scarlett also...
The War Prism!
War Prism going down. That's a massive pickup. And this should effectively shut down all the aggression.
Beautiful.
Oh, dude, on this map...
Even get more links into the main. And here we go. How many units do we have? We have 2 Adepts as well. Where are they? They're in the natural right now. Not doing anything, really. And, well, Scar's trying to come in here. Not really enough links to go for the surround, but getting close to that number. Now getting to that natural as well. And I gotta say, the microphone score at this game has been superb.
Oh, man. Really nice pullback as well there to make sure that those Adepts can't get any free damage on the links who are running around there.
Oh, my God. Those Adepts are gonna die, Tenshi.
Oh, one might get isolated. Some great mineral walking there from Jim to try to buffer for them, but it's not gonna be enough. 8 additional workers fall. There's still a decent number of links here. 2 Adepts pop out now, with the third one joining him. Finally going to clean up the lost lings, but the damage has been absolutely tremendous. 13 probes remaining. Scarlett back to droning, adding in a few more Zerglings. Just make sure that those Adepts can't find any additional counter damage. But Jim, he's in a terrible position.
Yeah, it was so important that Scarlett did find her one moment to really make those drones. And she did. She found the interval where she felt she had enough links. So right now, going up to 33 workers here and 16, it doesn't get much more. It doesn't get much better than this. And once again, the link
top
is set up and there's no unit in sight for this. There's one Stalker. Those Adepts are so far away on the map. This is devastating for Jim.
I love this from Scarlett. She just changes her avenue of attack. Gonna unload 6 Zerglings into the main base. Adepts, like you pointed out, man, they're way out of position on the reconnaissance mission, but they are gonna be getting those comms that there is something going down back at home. More probes will end up falling. Jim, yeah, I mean, he realizes that I'm way too far behind, and he's gonna tap out of game number one.
What a game from Scarlett. And even just, usually when you do this kind of build, like, yeah, you're going to deal a lot of damage as she got really far ahead, and then you can transition into a bit of a macro game. But this was just such a brutal beatdown in the very first map.
The damage control from Jim was initially good, but I'm really coming into question that cancel on the second gateway, mm-hmm. because that served to wall off as well, because there was like a lot of space in between the first gateway and the pylon. There were like 2 hexes. So you need to actually have 2 units on hold position to block that off, and Jim only had a single Zealot. I think that was like the most crucial mistake there, that he just gave away way too much space in the natural, which then gave him enough time to set up the drop overlord as well, comfortably. And obviously the lack of production, because, I mean, he's only squeezing out a single unit at a time.
Yes. I also think a big deal here was the fact that he was running around chasing the Lings. I think he should have actually left those Zealots right in the middle of the mineral line. So if Scott actually comes in and tries to attack his probes, he can easily defend right away and also pull his probes around the Zealots.
But it's really hard, you know, because you have to worry about the natural too, right?
Oh, yeah. But like when he was at the point where he had like 2 Zealots and 2 Adepts.
Oh, yeah.
Because he was splitting them up. But I think it's a very difficult position to defend. It is.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, being Protoss, I've been in that position so many times. It's like the bane of my existence, man. I think like 90% of all my losses in Legacy of the Void is because Links get into me, like into my main base of natural expansion in the early game. And you're just like...
Yeah, I mean, this is the kind of build that I want to see from Scarlett, though. She's so good at just these really quick, micro-intensive kind of battles.
Yeah, I love it.
Yeah, this is what I want to see from a Nurture, a Laser, and Scarlett. These are the players that really can do this well. Iasonia has also been known to do this, but he's out of his... He's kind of out of it right now.
That's just like... Right off the bat, like going for such a build, I was like, hey, that's sort of like Bly, you know?
Yeah, it's very like
that, Bly. That was the first thing that I was thinking, right? But guys, coming into game number 2, here in this best out of 5 in the rounds at 12, victor of this series is going to go off and face up against Maru. So that is also going to be a very tough one if you make it out of the rounds at 12, but at least you guarantee yourself, I believe it's like $8,000. Mm-hmm. Anyway, here we are on Whirlwind. And in the top right are Red Protoss. Hailing from China, is down on game already. It is going to be Jim.
His opponent in the bomb left-hand side on this huge macro map is going to be, from Canada, Scarlett. And well, Tenshi. Scarlett in the first game going really aggressive. This time, Hatchery first. Not going to see that super early speedling play. And I gotta say, this map, I really do think Scarlett has a fantastic chance on as well. Just because on the previous one, it's much easier to kind of start splitting up the...
Yesterday, Jim versus Kellos, he had a second War Prism. That's exactly what he needed in this circumstance. And I mean, he's going to start the second one, but this attack did nothing.
Yeah, and that third setup is not going to happen. I mean, you can vote in overcharge how much you ever want to. Those things are still going to tear through that pylon. We see Scarlett starting to transition, getting that eco going. And right now, Jim will have a really hard time setting up that third for a bit now. He's forcing a lot of warp-ins. And of course now, he does have the Dark Shrine, so we can see the DTs coming out. But we already have a few Spore Callers out. And of course, a Lair on the way.
I mean, Scarlett has got all of the tools that she needs there to basically hard counter the composition that Jim is using right now. It's going to be Adepts, a couple of DTs, maybe even make them into Archon. But versus all of these plus one Lings, it's going to be so, so tough. And Scarlett's creep spread is starting to further extend itself out on the map, so the mobility is going to be even better here for Scarlett. And she knows, man, no third base. She knows that Jim is going super all in with this. It's like a layer cake for the Chinese players.
Yeah, an all in cake.
Yeah, you start small and then it just expands.
Right now, Jim is moving out on the map here with a few Archons, really liking that decision to not go for those DTs, instead just using the Archons in front to tank. But of course, Scarlett has been adding only units. He went up to 56 workers, which is okay number. Doesn't go overboard with it, adding so many Banelings. Just gotta watch out though, because there is a choke here with those destructible debris right next to it. So gotta be careful, but that's a lot of energy on those queens as well.
Yeah, really important that you point that out, Alex. The transfusions here to keep that spine crawler to cement the defense, really key. Big wolf, big swell with morphing Banelings. And bear in mind, even though there's no Baneling speed on top of creep, splitting is going to be really tough. He wants to use the Archons to soak the Banelings. Good focus fire here from Jim. Is it going to be enough though? Scarlett wrapped around from left and right. Banelings on all sides. And the last Archon gets isolated and taken out. Yeah, this is going to be it.
Yeah,
Jim
so
can't do anything.
Jesus. I mean, that's a textbook goal tension.
Yeah, that was just perfect from Scarlett. Absolutely perfect. To you Zergs out there, watch and learn. This is how you do it. Jim, obviously, with a little bit of an unorthodox all-in on top of an all-in. But in this position, like, it's probably so tough. And now with Baneling speed finishing up, it's going to be even harder. Jim, so far behind. I think this game is going to be over soon.
Yeah, he's trying to warp in even more, but that's going to be GG. And Scarlett takes the second map really quickly as she's now up 2-0 against the Chinese player.
A very quick start here to this series. Can he turn things around, though?
It's going to be difficult.
He's just doing all-ins on all-ins on all-ins. Mm. I just think this is what we're seeing is a just lack of confidence to go toe-to-toe with Scarlett in the longer game.
I mean, well, in the first game, it was actually Scarlett going for the semi-all-in. So, I mean, Jim never really had a chance to go for it. And then now in the second game, like, he was trying to go into the third base behind the pressure, but that's not going to happen when you have like that many links.
Yeah, no way.
So Scarlett playing this very cleverly. She's not going for that super greedy kind of macro and reactive style that we do see sometimes, because it does open up for so many variables they can't always scout for. But I got to say, though, what's so impressive with this, what Scarlett did now, was she was adding the plus one for the Hydra. She added the Hydra Den.
Yeah,
so behind this, she was ready for an attempt at a third, going into Hydraling Bane and hitting that disgustingly good time.
Yeah, she had all of the tools like back at home that she was setting up. Just so in case that I can't just utterly crush him with this first wave of units, she has the perfect follow-up, because, I mean, at this point, the gases are so late for Jim. He's going to be starting to mine out his main base. So he doesn't really even have all that much money to squeeze in those very important units, like the splash damage, stuff as disruptors, more Archons. And then Hydras, I mean, gateway units, terrible versus Hydras. It's perfectly played out there from Scarlett. And now we're going to go into game number three, ladies and gents. Overgrowth is going to be the potentially deciding map in this best of five in the rounds of 12. To see who's going to be the first player to move up and face off against Maru, but also secure those $8,000 to pocket.
And that's a lot of money just for
it
series.
It is a lot of money. I mean, especially if you live in China.
Oh, yeah. I got to say, though, the one who wins this and goes up against Maru, that's going to be a difficult one.
Yeah.
I mean, basically,
Maru
it's going to be the final boss.
Yeah. I mean, Maru is favored to win the whole thing.
Yeah, definitely. I think right now it's like Maru and then TY, and then we try to find out like who's going to be number three, basically.
My number three is actually Showtime.